Algonquin Young Readers and Workman Audio present The Ogress and the Orphans by Kelly Barnhill. Read by Suzanne Torin. Ignorance is the cause of fear. Seneca. No act of kindness, no matter how small, is ever wasted. Aesop. Chapter 1. Pay attention. Listen. This is a story about an ogress. She is not who you might think she is, but really is anyone. The ogress lived in a crooked house at the far edge of town. She enjoyed baking and gardening and counting the stars. Like all ogres, the ogress was quite tall. Even sizable adults would have to crane their necks and squint a bit to say hello. She had feet the size of tortoises, hands the size of herons' wings, and a broad, broad brow that cracked and creased when she concentrated. Her skin was like granite, and her eyes looked like brand new pennies. Her hair sprouted and waved from her head like prairie grass. Stiff and yellow and green, sometimes spangled with daisies or dandelions or creeping ivy. Like all ogres, she spoke little and thought much. She was careful and considerate. Her heavy feet trod lightly on the ground. This is also a story about a family of orphans. There were 15 orphans living in the orphan house at the time our story begins, several years after the ogress first arrived in town. There were too many children for one house, but they made do. Their names were Anthea, Bartleby, Cassandra, who preferred Cass, Deirdre, Elijah, Fortunate, Gratitude, Hiram, Iggy, Justina, Kai, Lily, Maud, and the babies, Nanette and Orpheus. They were good children, these orphans, studious and hardworking and kind. And they loved one another dearly, ever so much more than they loved themselves. The ogress, too, was hardworking and kind and generous. She also loved others more than she loved herself. This can be a problem, of course, sometimes. But it can also be a solution. Let me show you how. Chapter 2. The Dragon. This is also a story about a dragon. I do not like to talk about him much. I don't even like to think about him. I should clarify, it is not my intention to speak ill of dragons generally. It is a terrible practice to prejudge anyone, be they ogres or orphans or dragons or nosy neighbors or assistant principals or people with unusual manners. It is important always to treat everyone with compassion and respect. This is well known. As for dragons in particular, they are as diverse in their dispositions as any other creature. I myself have encountered dragons of every personality type: shy, gregarious, lazy, fastidious, self-centered, big-hearted, enthusiastic, and brave. But this dragon, I'm sorry to say, was none of those things. This dragon was greedy, perfidious, and indifferent. He felt no remorse, and he had not been redeemed. He delighted in discord and sowed acrimony wherever he went. These are all large words, and I apologize for them, but my feelings about this dragon are large. Listen. I would like nothing more than to tell you that every person, human, dragon, or any other kind of creature, is fundamentally good. But I can't tell you that, because it is not in my nature to lie. Everyone starts fundamentally good, in my experience, and nearly everyone stays mostly good, for the most part. But some, well, they choose to do bad things. No one knows why. And then a small number of those choose to stay bad. I wish it weren't true. But it's best you know this now, at the beginning of this book. Every story has a villain, after all. And every villain has a story. Chapter 3. The Town. This is also a story about a place called Stone in the Glen, which used to be a lovely town. Everyone said so. Stone in the Glen had been famous for its trees, shade trees in parks, blossoming trees in the walkways, fruit trees lining the neighborhood streets with limbs that bent under the weight of an abundant harvest each season. Anyone, any neighbor or friend or visitor from far, far away, could reach up when the time was right and simply help themselves. People filled their baskets with apricots and persimmons, cherries and plums, apples and pears, depending on the time of year. They perfected recipes for tarts and pies and jams. They cooked fruit into candies, which they kept next to their front doors to give out to neighborhood children as they passed by. The streets in Stone in the Glen were a thing to behold in those days. People walked slowly under blossoming or green or fruiting boughs, taking their time as they enjoyed the dappled shade. Each night, street sweepers and scrubbers washed the cobblestones clean. The lamps, made from blown glass and polished lovingly by hand, glittered at night like stars. The street signs hadn't yet gone missing, nor had the public art, back when it was a lovely town. In those days, townspeople lounged in the promenades and the public square, discussing literature, or politics, or philosophy, or art. All roads in town then led to the library, which had wide windows, tall shelves, and deep cushions on the sofas, and which welcomed everyone. There were hand-bound books, and modern books, and ancient scrolls, and even texts carved into stones. The librarians bustled this way and that, sorting, preserving, shelving, and shushing. Even their shushes were lovely. Neighbors worked together to make soup for the sick and cookies for classrooms. They swarmed like worker bees when a tree fell on a fence, or when a roof needed mending, or when somebody's mother had broken a leg. Neighbors cared for one another once upon a time, back when it was a lovely town. But then, one terrible night, the library burned. Different people remember terrible events differently. There were many stories explaining what happened that night in Stone in the Glen, and nearly all of them disagreed. Some insisted that it was a miscreant who set the fire, claiming that they had heard footsteps echoing with sinister purpose, moving toward the venerable building and then scampering away once the flames erupted. Others swore they had heard the wings of a dragon flying overhead. Dragons were more common in those days than they are now, after all. And who loves fire more than a dragon? Others shook their heads and said that the fire had been inevitable. The place was a tinderbox.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.